I would like to pay respect to the traditional owners of this land where we are standing, and it is my absolute pleasure to be coming to this country. And I was telling my friends, this is the 16th time I'm coming to Fiji, so you may get some idea how much I love this country. I feel very happy when I come, but I feel very sad when I go. But I'm always looking for a reason to come back. I'd also like to pay my respect to lots of other people, and I'll start with Derek, acting vice chancellor, the Dean of Faculty of Arts, Law and Education, Dr. Akanesi Kendriati, my very good friend, Professor Konai Helu Thaman, and honored guest. I can see some names here. I see some faces. Felipe, Sima, Priscilla. It's good to see all those people that I know from many, many years who are making a significant difference in this country and across the Pacific. So really excited to be here. So the idea about our presentation, I'll give you a little bit of context, what we are going to do. So we come from different countries, but we bring different experiences. So when AC asked me, let's have a symposium, talk about the things that are working in your context, and are there any important lessons that we can learn, we have learned in our context that you can take back to your own country. So what I'm going to do is I'll start with, I think you need to know who is this person who's talking here. Well, I can say I work at Monash University. I'm head of the department in educational psychology and inclusion. That's nothing. When I want to introduce myself as a learner. So every time I walk in a country, walk in a classroom, I always looking for what I can learn in this thing. So I want to introduce myself as a learner. When I go in different countries, contexts, I'm always looking for what is there that I can learn. So please pay attention to all the images that I'm going to use on each slide. I think that's the key message you should be taking from different slides. So the very first slide is heart, head, and hands. So that's an area which I'm very interested in lately. So what I believe, if you start making a difference in our teacher education, in our classrooms, we need to have people who believe in three things. Number one, they should believe that if I cannot teach really well in this particular classroom, if there is a student is struggling, the problem is with the way I teach. So it's my belief that's influencing. It's not the student. So what we need to do in our teacher education is start looking for ways that people start believing that how will I make sure that this child who's going to come to my classroom gets best out of his, you know, from this classroom. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, teachers always struggle. You know, you said there is a child who has any particular need, which some people call it special educational need. What I'm going to do about this? So they say, can you teach me some strategies? Very important. But one thing I must blame myself, people like us who teach in universities, sometimes we can make messages so difficult that teachers get scared. We start using terminology that they say, I can't use this. So I think it's very, very important for all of us who are in teacher education to make the messages very simple. When I come to Pacific, if I start using cooperative learning, differentiated instruction, people saying, what are you talking about? This might work in, you know, Australia. Tell us something that works in our context. And I was talking to Lai. There are so many things that you do in this country. So what you need to start doing is connect people with the local knowledge first. So when I talk about cooperative learning, talk about things that you do together. So that's the kind of things we need to start building upon what we do really well and then move forward. So I'm coming from, I was born in India and I'm in Australia for last 22 years or 26 years. What I'm doing, I work in with Department of Education in New South Wales, Victoria, and I'm also working across the Pacific, India, Bangladesh, China. So what I'm learning is, what I'm going to share with you is what I have seen works, what I have seen does not work. But I will not say, I'm not going to give you a very long lecture. I'm going to give you three or four main things that, in my view, makes a difference. Okay, can we go to the next slide, please? And again, I'm telling you, just keep look at the images that I'm going to share. So I have a rose and some thorns. I could have easily said, you know, Australia is not the best country to look for inclusive practices. We make a lot of mistakes. So what I'm trying to do is, I'm going to look for things that have worked in our system. I'm not saying all schools are very inclusive or all schools do very well. What I've seen is some schools do really well. So that's what I'm going to share with you. And what are those things when we do well? What happens? What works? So things that work in our system is, I have seen, if you go to a school, and school principal, school teacher, and kids say, that we believe in inclusion, or I believe in inclusion, or then inclusion starts working. And you go to another school where they say, well, we do inclusion on Monday or Friday, inclusion does not work. So schools that do really well inclusion are those schools, they say that inclusion is our school's philosophy. So they all believe that all kids should come to my classroom or my school, and that makes my school a much better school. So they believe in this idea. So the principal believes in, the school teachers believe in, so this is the heart. Unless they have a heart for inclusion, it's not going to work. So that's the first thing we have seen, and that's the area we are doing a lot of research into. The second thing is, you know, you will not believe, teachers in Australia say that we need more funding to do inclusion. And I said, why don't let's go to Bangladesh, let's see what you will do then. So I mean, what will you do if you take Australian teachers to Bangladesh? What will they say? I said, can you teach in a classroom of 70 kids? They will run away, and some of them might commit suicide, I can tell you. So what I'm saying is resource or funding is very important. The question that we should be asking is, if you need more funding, ask them, what do you need it for? So what we should be teaching in teacher education is not more resources, but how to be more resourceful. So whatever you have, we need to be teaching how to be a creative resource finder. So that's what I have learned. Schools that do really well, they don't wait to get more funding. They start doing the good work from the day one. But they also believe that they cannot do it, they cannot make their school inclusive on day one. It's a journey, it's a process, it takes time. But they believe that they are going to try their best to make it more inclusive. And the third thing is, I think this is very critical for all of us. Sometimes teachers believe in an idea, school principals believe in an idea, but we forget, without support, inclusion does not work. So we need to support teachers, we need to support principals, and if you start doing those three things, you will be amazed that, you know, how well the inclusion starts working in different school systems. So it's important for us to think about as we move along this journey. So I think the thing about rose, some thorns, I'm just sharing some of the important messages that, or some of the things that I've seen in different countries. So when I use the example of Bangladesh, I can spend all day just talking to you about the project we did. And we have seen that inclusion can work in classes where there are not enough resources. The reason is because the teachers were more resourceful. They were looking for answers. That's why it works. Can we go to the next slide? Oh, sorry. So why I think they work? So what is the reason in my view why some systems are working or some schools are working? So these are some of the important ideas. Number one, relationships. In schools where principal does not have a good relationship with the teacher, teacher does not have good relationship with students, students don't have good relations with other students, inclusion doesn't work. So at the foundation of good inclusion should be relationships. So forget about all the strategies. You say first priority should be, how will we make sure that everyone has a good relationship in this school system? And I'm asking this question to teacher educators who are sitting in this room, some of you might be. What will you do about this when we are preparing our teachers? How will we make sure that they learn that relationship is the power, that's how you start your journey with? Beliefs, as I already told you, you know, it comes back every time. Schools that work really well, they all believe inclusion is the foundation to provide high quality education to all children. If a principal says inclusion is an additional responsibility, I think they got the message wrong completely. So very, very important, they need to believe inclusion is a way to provide high quality education to all children. We must support the teachers and the school. If we can't support schools and teachers, inclusion will survive for a short time while the policies are coming, while the funding is coming from overseas countries. The moment you take the funding out, it will not be sustained. So we need to think about the ways we will continue to support our teachers and our communities. Are very, very important. And flexibility at the school level is very important. Exam systems in many countries are a problem. So you need to start thinking about, if you are a policymaker sitting in this room, what will you do about this? Because that's a genuine barrier to inclusion. So how will you allow teachers and schools to be more flexible when they start teaching? Can we have a system where teachers can still work with those students who are failing? How best they will make support that they are supported in our system and they don't fail? Because they say, well, everyone has to write this exam. This one cannot write this exam, so he or she cannot be part of our system. So think about this. And another lesson learned is, be a learner. I think I hate to say that people who walk in a school system saying that I'm an expert, they make a big mistake. I think every time you walk in a school, if you're a good learner, you'll be amazed how many changes you can make in the classroom with principals, with teachers. So take that approach. It works for me. I'm sure if you took this, it might work for you as well. Look for solutions that will work in your context. I think we tend to forget that context matters. You cannot get a model that is working in Italy or in Australia or USA or a strategy that working there and say, we will use it. It may not work. You always need to look for solutions that are relevant to your own context. So think about what's working here. And I would say that must look at all the cultural practices, the religious practices, and how best we can work with and around them. Very, very critical. And last but not the last, again, you look at this is a very important figure that I'm saying. If you can't find a solution, please make mistakes. Why I'm telling you this? What we tend to, we should not be doing the same thing again and again, but and our students are failing. I'm saying as a teacher, as a pre-service teacher, we must be, or teacher educators, we must be making mistakes if you don't know the solutions. Just don't let those things go for many, many years. Make mistakes and learn from those mistakes. I think that's the important message I wanted to say. So thank you very much, all my good friends. I think we'll be again coming back and, you know, sharing more examples. And I hand it over to Missy.